This evening on the Rock Newman Show, finding our children. What are we missing is a part of WHUT's broad-based initiative on missing and exploited children. Many of us have seen and heard the heartbreaking stories about missing children in our area. We'll dive into a discussion about this disturbing problem with DC Police Commander Chanel Dickerson, ANC Commissioner Sharece Crawford, President of the Black and Missing Foundation, Derrica Wilson, and Reverend Moya Harris of Metropolitan AME Church. They'll join me to break down how local communities, political players, and the media are handling this issue and what steps can be taken to protect our Black and Brown children. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. The DC Metropolitan Police Department has recorded over 500 cases of missing children so far in 2017, with over a dozen cases currently open. Now, under the media's microscope and with political pressure mounting, D.C. Police and Mayor Muriel Bowser are working to not only locate D.C.'s missing girls, but also secure solutions to curb the city's rate of missing children. Joining me now to break down the social, legal, and political faux pas of this issue and what proactive measures everyone can take to protect our Black and Brown children are D.C. Police Commander Chanel Dickerson, President of the Black and Missing Foundation, Derrica Wilson, ANC Commissioner Sharece Crawford, and Reverend Moya Harris of Metropolitan AME Church. I want to welcome all of you. Thank you so much for joining us here today on The Rock Newman Show.
Thank you for having us.
All right. Commander, I want to go first to you. It was somewhere, I think, in the early part of February, I was out of town, I was in Florida. And I started looking, I woke up one day and I was looking at my social media, Facebook and the rest of it. And it seemed to be a barrage of information that, I mean, quickly galvanized into hysteria as to what the community and the social media was saying. Well, I looked for news reports and I, you know, didn't see too many, I saw some. So I want to ask you a question. That hysteria that was whipped up on social media, one, given the circumstances and the condition on the ground, do you think that that was overblown? That's one question about social media, overblown on social media. And as an official member of the police department, do you guys do anything? What do you do to try to counteract hysteria and false information that is so prevalent on social media?
Well, thank you for asking that question. I definitely don't think that it was, blown out of proportion. And mm-hmm. the reason why I state that is because we're talking about our children. Mm-hmm. So I started the social media push, and I expected not the hysteria, but mm-hmm. I did expect the awareness piece, mm-hmm. that was my goal. Mm-hmm. And what the police department has done and did very quickly is I conducted several interviews, we did press releases, we had a press conference with Mayor Bowser mm-hmm. to promote our awareness in this new initiative.
So when you say you started the social media from within the department, you went out on social media to discuss the issue?
Yes, I started it. I was assigned to the Youth and Family Services Division mm-hmm. on December the 23rd mm-hmm. of 2016. Right. And I noticed that officers and detectives had a discretion of what cases were posted on social media mm-hmm. and press releases. And I just mandated that all cases are treated the same and investigated the same way.
Uh-huh. Okay, so before I go to our next guest, so is it your sense that we certainly never want to minimize exactly. the importance of one child being missing.
Exactly.
One child being missing. But subsequent to what I refer to as the hysteria, Mayor Bowser and others have come forth to say we have a different way that we are counting and categorizing missing children. So is it the general sense that it's not as extreme as what we first heard? Like, you thought, you know, I thought I was going to come home and not see any young kids on the street. They were all going to be gone. I mean, it was that kind of hysteria. So is it an epidemic, or was that overplayed in terms of the actual numbers? And to Mayor Bowser's point about the different counting, because she seemed to try to calm fears in that manner.
Well, in reference to the counting, the numbers are what they are. Mm-hmm. However, our total number, like as of this morning, was 984 missing persons in D.C. However, multiple people have been reported missing multiple times. So uh-huh. those numbers are actually counted in that number. Uh-huh. So maybe that's what you're talking about in reference to the count.
Uh-huh.
Over the last 5 years, and I think we probably said it on a press conference, that there has been a decline in the number. And just like you said, we're not trying to minimize the number, but uh-huh. we wanted to point out that there has been a decline. And we closed almost like 99% of the missing person cases.
Okay. You're in Ward 8, Sharece. That is the area that most that where most of the missing have been reported. What are you doing, and what do you feel? What's in the street? What's the feel in the street about this issue?
Well, thank you for the question, and thank you for this very important panel. We helped to organize the town hall meeting. I'm not sure if you saw some footage of that meeting or if you were able to attend, but the hysteria was not necessarily for the lower and the numbers going down. It was the lack of people feeling heard. I think that people had questions, they had concerns, and they wanted their voices to be heard and their expressions to be felt. Mm-hmm. And when I saw social media commentary from the mayor's office responding to civilians to say that, oh, the numbers are low, you know, kind of don't worry about it, does not, for my constituents, were screaming that this is not how we feel heard. And so at that town hall meeting is what you saw, people who felt like their concerns were being suppressed.
Uh-huh. Not fully acknowledged.
Not fully acknowledged. When this situation came to my desk, it was the probably second week of March, and people started to call to say, well, what is, you know, why is there no media attention? This is what was coming to my emails, mm-hmm. to social media, on my phone. Mm-hmm. Why is there not national news in regards to the missing persons? These were the questions I got repeatedly. Mm-hmm. And so my first step was to say, okay, let me go to check MPD site to see what the real numbers are.
Right.
And so my immediate frustration was that there were no numbers. As of March 14th, when I looked at the website, there was one missing person, and that was Relisha Rudd over 3 years ago. And so that's when, you know, my role, a large part of my role, is to advise D.C. government agencies mm-hmm. of the needs of our constituents. Mm-hmm. And having a lack of missing persons that have been reported, having a lack of their presence being there, was a part of a greater challenge to me to say that maybe there is more to what these people, my constituents, were claiming in regards to not seeing the missing persons, the attention being given to the mm-hmm. missing persons.
You have the foundation.
Yes.
Missing. What, when did you form? Why did you form, and what do you do?
Black and Missing Foundation was founded in 2008 to bring awareness to missing persons of color. And when my sister-in-law and I founded the organization, 30% of missing persons in the United States were persons of color, and that number has since increased to 40%. According to the FBI. And so what we have done, I'm in law enforcement, my background is law enforcement, and Natalie in public relations, we channel our professions to help the minority community, because this is an epidemic that has been going on for quite some time. It did not just pop up in February or March. It is something that has been going on for quite some time. And I will say that I do applaud Commander Dickerson's efforts to push this issue, because one of the concerns that we've had time and time again is the fact that we can't always wait on the 5 and the 10 o'clock news cycle. Mm-hmm. I was just in New York last week and I boarded an Amtrak Acceler train at 12 o'clock. I was in New York at 2:30 and not one person ever asked for my identification because I printed my ticket out. So what we're trying to do is get into the minds of people to be more vigilant. Just mm-hmm. because someone is missing out of Washington, D.C. does not mean that they're still in Washington, D.C. So what we're doing, we're raising awareness and we're also taking the proactive approach to educate our community on personal safety.
Yeah.
Reverend Moya Harris. From the faith-based community, how much are you all involved, one, in the information gathering and the support to be able to stem the tide and stem the flow of missing persons?
Well, to be honest, Metropolitan hasn't really been on the front end yet, mm-hmm. but as of yesterday, I was asked to be a part of the NAACP Women in NAACP meeting to mm-hmm. see how we can help to advocate. We have a large community in our congregation. We are known for advocating, and the women's ministry, a big part of us is helping to liberate women and help to advocate. So we really haven't been on the front end, but we're looking for places where we can partner and use our leverage, where our pastor can use his voice and go to City Hall and advocate. And we have a lot of lawyers that are working with juvenile justice, so we do have people in place. We're just looking for places where we can organize and be effective instead of just being another group doing a little bit of work. How can we be more effective?
Yeah. So. You use the term epidemic.
Yes.
Do you feel this is an epidemic?
I do, but I agree with her that it's not new. Mm-hmm. It's not new.
Okay, so here's what happened when we embraced this subject.
Yeah.
We initially, I think, were inspired to look into this because of the blaring headlines. There were blaring headlines, mm-hmm. you know, kids missing. Mm-hmm. And then, frankly speaking, in part as a result of Mayor Bowser's appearance on some cable news shows, it appeared as if the hysteria, and I'll keep using this term, the hysteria mm-hmm. might have overblown, and that it was an administrative issue in terms of the way that missing were now counted as opposed to it was how it was counted at one time. So I know that, for example, I relaxed a little bit. I felt a little more assured that there was no epidemic. And so that's two extremes, and we've gone from one to the other. Where should we be?
I think people need to understand and realize that we are dealing with a crisis, and one missing child is one too many. You know, we are battling a variety of reasons why people are going missing, whether it's domestic violence, whether it's mental health, human trafficking. That is an issue that is plaguing our community, and yet we're not talking about it. And so we need to have these conversations, because the efforts in which Commander Dickerson utilized the social media platform has awakened our community. And what we need is for them to continue to be vigilant and know that this is an issue. This is not the sole responsibility of law enforcement. Mm-hmm. It's law enforcement, it's the media, and more importantly, it is the community. And so as we're getting this information out there, the more people that know about it, the greater the chances of a reunion. Mm-hmm. And this is not something that's just going on right here in D.C.
Yeah.
This is all over the country.
Yeah. Well, you know, when I became aware the WHUT wanted to do a full-throated, take a full-throated approach to this and really kind of find out the reality of what was happening, I certainly wanted to support that. Sharece, I saw you shaking your head.
Well, so I think it goes back to the resolutions that a part of the resolutions that we submitted was that what makes it a crisis is that we needed more systems in place to support the commander's efforts in getting the word out. Mm-hmm. I think a big part of that was what we recommended, to have someone to really maintain and update our websites on a consistent basis. There needs to be someone solely focused on the data, solely focused on the numbers. In addition, there is a responsibility for other agencies to be involved, and those should be listed as resources on MPD's website. Those are the kinds of systems that need to be put in place. So for example, if I'm a constituent, like I get those calls every day, and I'm trying to figure out, like you, where do I begin? Well, I go to MPD's website. And when there's a lack of resources, there's a lack of information, then what we saw with some celebrities, numbers started to get made up. They were kind of creating their own news, their own story to kind of piece together what was actually happening. And so those are the kinds of things that happen when the background documents or background sources are not there. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that we're looking at is, another crisis, I think, is with an Amber Alert. If we have that many persons gone missing in Washington, D.C., and there not be one Amber Alert, not any of those persons fit the criteria for an Amber Alert, then we need to look at modifying the criteria. Yeah. And if we cannot modify the criteria, then we need to create our own system.
Commander, can you please explain what the criteria is to initiate an Amber Alert?
Well, the Amber Alert is a national system. It's an early notification system that law enforcement agencies use. However, we have to have reason to believe that the juvenile has been kidnapped or abducted and is in imminent danger. And unfortunately, none of our cases, I guess we can look at it like fortunately, none of our cases actually fit that criteria.
Okay, so if you can do this, and if someone else wants to kind of jump in and help with what your understanding is, but I'll ask you, from an official member of the D.C. government, how do you define, what criteria is used to define a missing person, a missing child?
Well, just like with a missing person, if you're missing from your lawful place of abode, that's what our policy states. But it doesn't have to be just your place of abode. It can be wherever you are supposed to be,
and there's no minimum. Like for is there a certain hour, if that's 24 hours?
No, there's no minimum time requirement to file a missing person report in the District of Columbia.
I think if we had more people that were passionate like Commander Dickerson, I think the community response would be a little bit better, because some of the cases that have been brought to our attention, because we do partner with law enforcement, we've had cases where the police report wasn't simply taken. And so we know in the District of Columbia, as well as like a state such as Illinois, there is no time crunch as it relates to filing a missing persons report. But we have had issues where the family could not simply get a police report taken, even in the Metropolitan Police Department.
Okay, so I have a question. I don't mean to put anybody on the panel here on the spot, but it's something that I think needs to be addressed. So has the mayor, in her, I think what was an effort to quell the fears, to quiet down and to some extent protect the image of the district, when she talked about the different way of counting, and so therefore don't be as alarmed as what you currently are, did that help or hurt the struggle?
I think that the mayor responding to the crisis, one, was a good start to actually respond. I think the challenge that my constituents had was the grouping of the missing persons all as runaways, is the grouping of, to make it as if that all of these children have ran away, and then the questions are there, well, if they all ran away and you're claiming that all the homes are unstable, how are they safely returned to unstable homes? How are they safely returned to homes that are unsafe? What actions have been taken? What resources have been provided? what programs have been given to the parents, what are the next steps for that child. Yeah. I think that it lacked the substance in that area. It lacked the substance to say, here's what we've recommended, here's what we're recommending for families. And I think that resources like Black and Missing can be a resource added to MPD's website. I think that enhances the website. There were people who've been doing this work for years that I hadn't discovered until social media investigating, that I feel like could be found if MPD were to partner with these organizations to say these are advocates in missing persons, these are advocates in human trafficking. Here's how you can find the next seminar. Here's how you can find the next session. And that would make people feel a little more comfortable mm-hmm. about having resources. What's next? What are my steps? Yeah. What can I do to participate? Mm-hmm. Because those are all real concerns. People want to know, how can I get involved? Yeah. I had a group of over 50 individuals contact me saying, hey, we want to support this cause. And I didn't have a plan to give them. I didn't know what, and we didn't necessarily roll out a plan to say,
sure.
This is what we're doing for the community to be engaged outside of social media.
Rem Harris, back to the faith-based community.
Yes.
You mentioned sort of your women's ministry.
Yes.
It's clear that a lot of DC households are headed by a single parent female.
Right.
Some of the missing, a large number of the missing are coming from those single family homes headed by the female. So in your women's ministry, what would you, what if anything are you doing or planning to do to try to help those single moms prevent their kids
right.
from leaving?
I think prevention is key. How do you keep the children from getting to the point that they want to run away or be in vulnerable situations where someone might snatch them out of the home or put them in situations where they make difficult choices that yeah. could ruin their lives? Mentoring is key, and mentoring parenting. We in the past have done some mentoring, and we're doing a lot of revamping with the women's ministry. We have relaunched in the past year, mm-hmm. but we're looking at how we can do some advocating, some education, partnering with other organizations. I know the NAACP, we're gonna do an event, I think it's gonna be next month, that we're trying to do some mentoring and branding for young women, young adult women. And we have an awesome church school where we have a lot of young parents that bring their children and make it in a safe haven. So mm-hmm. I think having a space where you can bring families know that they can be safe, that they can look for help if they need to, I think that's key.
You know, it would seem to me that if ever there were a time for the faith-based community to coalesce,
right,
to come together,
right,
to develop a strategy,
right,
from where they are right in the communities and sort of have a sort of a global approach to this issue, if ever there was a time right. for the church right. to come together, this right. would be it.
Right. And yeah. Well, in our church, we have our annual conferences next week, so all of our churches are coming together, and our presiding elder is very active in being on the cusp of ministries that are relevant. So that's something that churches right here in the DMV could come together and do that, because we
saying?
Don't.
I was actually on the panel with Sharece and Commander Dickerson in Ward 8, and one of the things that I actually did was called out the faith-based communities, because they are the pillar in our communities. And as we discussed during that panel discussion, you know, we have so many professions under that one roof.
Yeah.
We have a lot of children, as you stated, and which mm-hmm. we stated during the town hall, that are coming from single-family homes. What are you prepared to do? Because we have hit the ground running trying to partner with the faith-based communities. Mm-hmm. And so during that town hall, we had one pastor to stand up. He actually led the prayer, but afterwards he said, I want to do more.
Yeah.
And as a result, that following Sunday, we actually had a panel, just like we're sitting here now, to educate the congregation on what the issues are and to also provide a solution. So we have partnered up, and now we are actually teaching kids self-defense techniques, training free of charge. We brought in a professional trainer because we want to arm our children. We're all about being proactive. We're not a reactive organization. We want to arm you with the skills, the knowledge, and the techniques up front to deter anything from happening.
Absolutely.
Okay, so I mean, I have about 2,000 questions and not enough time to ask them.
And before that, I just want to clarify something that I heard Sharece say, because I don't know where that information came from, because she said that, like, she suggested that the police department actually return children to unsafe homes. The police department does not knowingly return a child to an unsafe home. Uh-huh. We would then contact CFSA, the Child and Family Services Agency.
Okay.
And actually place that child with them. Mm-hmm. And then they will decide the safe place for that child.
Mm-hmm. And that's exactly where the questions come in, Commander, is because when you get a report that says this child is returned, found safely, and then there is, you know, the mayor saying these are all runaways and that we need to check with the families, and there's no further, and the specific question was asked at the town hall forum, is there an investigation going on? And the response was no. So when you say that there's no investigation, you don't discuss what resources were provided for the family, it leads people to believe that the child is returning to a home that's unstable, or that there's been no investigation to determine where that child left to go to, where they came from, what was the conditions in the home.
If I may interject really quick, not from MPD side, mm-hmm. I'll let you answer that, but that is an actual question that we get quite often on our social media pages when we're posting about children that are found and we're saying that they have been found safe. We can't always give the particulars because some cases are so sensitive in nature. Mm-hmm. And for example, the young girl that we found out of Baltimore that was trafficked in DC and found in Prince George's County, yes, we alerted the community that she was found safe, but there was underlying issues and the investigation is still continuing. We just need to let them know that they can no longer exhaust their resources in looking for this particular person. We can start looking for someone else, but that was the standard language that we were using and that we continue to use because a lot of the cases are sensitive and we have to be very careful when it comes to children also.
Well, even if we aren't giving specific language around that particular child, what are the resources for families that are seeking resources? I think that those are the kinds of things that people are looking for. You know, if your child goes missing, you know, where do you go to next? If your child is currently missing, what resources are available for the parent? These are the kinds of robust resources that I think can be shared to say, if your child is currently missing, these are X, Y, and Z programs that are available. If your child has X problem, these are programs and resources for your child. Mm-hmm. That's what we're talking about, and not necessarily in the particular of that specific child, but in the realm of kind of we're all dealing with this issue. Mm-hmm. Here's where you can go for support. Here's who's available to support your family in these times.
Commander, as a result of the attention, this is a spotlight now. This is a microscope that's on this issue. And I think it very much should be.
Absolutely.
Has that microscope prompted policy and behavior that is opening up? There was an arrest in the Pamela Butler case.
Saturday.
Yeah, and Alicia Rudd. Is this what has done that? Has that been ongoing with an Alicia Rudd? Or did this, you know, prompt some activity and behavior to try to more so wrap your hands, arms around the issue?
Well, I actually say that the Metropolitan Police Department is the best police department in the country. I mean, hey, probably because I work here, but that's what I state.
Okay.
We have some awesome detectives that's assigned to these cases, and these investigations were being actively investigated and suspects pursued before the social media push for missing persons.
Okay. So let me ask you, have there been incidences where there is a kid missing and the department gets the report that the kid is missing, opens up some sort of inquiry, investigation, whatever it might be, and then through the efforts of the department go and locate a child and bring it away from harm? Has that happened? Are you aware?
Well, we have definitely located kids, but since I have been in the unit, and I can't speak for the statistics prior to me arriving there, yeah. We have not gone to a location where a child was in a dangerous situation and located them. However, we have located them and reunited them with their family.
Okay. You brought up a four-letter word, man, human trafficking.
Mm-hmm.
And how much of the issue of missing children do you think is a part of human trafficking? Let's talk. We're in D.C. We're talking about D.C. kids. Let's talk about in D.C. How much? So, and I want you to do something for my audience, for me and my audience.
Okay.
Define human trafficking.
Human trafficking is modern day slavery. It's the entrapment of someone for sexual favors or for labor, holding them against their will.
And that's taking place in the district.
That is taking place here and all over. That is a multi-million dollar industry that is happening here. And from my organization's standpoint, I just can't speak solely right here on DC. I have to speak for the DMV in general. And, you know, it's quite unnerving knowing that Maryland is number 5 in the country for human trafficking. There is a hub right there. You have the Baltimore port. You have the 495 corridor. So when you think of these children going missing, and as I was stating to you, this young girl that was trafficked from Baltimore ended up in DC. So you would think that children that are missing in DC could possibly end up in Baltimore or Virginia. This is something that's going on. And so
do you know the mechanics of that particular case? You say trafficked from Baltimore ended up in Prince George County.
She was lured online by a sexual predator. Her mother had done everything right to make sure that she doesn't have any, and she was autistic, that she doesn't have any devices, electronics. She used someone's device at school, and she's the type of kid, because that was a case that we worked, she's the type of kid that her disability have her trusting everyone.
Yeah.
She sees everyone one way, that no one is gonna do any harm to her.
Yeah.
And so, 16 years old.
Yeah.
16, she was missing for 6 days. So this is something that's going on here and all around the country.
Okay, so she used someone else's device. Walk me through what happened.
So she used someone else's device. She was on an app, it was a dating app. She met some guy. They started corresponding, you know, while she was at school, and they made arrangements. He actually picked her up. So when her mother said, "See you later," that morning, she thought she was going on to school, and she ended up getting in the car with this young man, and she was trafficked from Odenton, Maryland, to D.C., where she was under the command of many men. And it was an Uber driver that provided a tip to our organization that actually dropped her off in Prince George's County at 3:38 in the morning.
And you said under the command of many men.
Of many men.
Have they been identified?
It's still active. The FBI is involved now, so this is bigger than the Baltimore Police Department. But she did, when she was recovered, she actually indicated to law enforcement that there were other girls involved that were held against their will at the initial stop.
Where was the initial stop? Do we know?
Odenton, Maryland.
Okay, no, what I'm saying is when they got here, were they in a hotel? Were they in someone's apartment, someone's house?
Apartment.
And you're not able to, like, talk about names just yet?
No, because it's under investigation. And for the integrity of the investigation, we don't want to jeopardize. With human trafficking, it's a network. This is like the war, like it was back in the day, the war on drugs. It's now the war on our children, boys and girls, because I think that's another misconception. Everyone is in an uproar about DC missing girls, but it's boys too.
Mm-hmm. So there are active criminal enterprises.
Oh, yes.
That are preying on children that they will seduce from a home, wherever they may be, to take that child and turn them into sex servants, if you will.
And I will say this, and there has been stories that have come out, and I know that, I mean, I'm a former cop too, so every department has that one bad apple, so.
Yeah.
But no, DC actually had an arrest too, to be exact, for human trafficking, and then the latest one that they had.
From someone who was a member of the police department.
Yes.
And that's where the outrage is coming from. You know, mm-hmm. It's minimizing. It's the fact that that happened, and then the community is kind of feeling that their concerns around it are being minimized. There was actually a call for an external investigation during our town hall forum.
So the ones you're running for help are the ones that, mm-hmm. you know, you may be afraid of, and not all, but like I said, I was a cop, so the good suffer with the bad, but you know, trying to weed out the bad officers with the ill intentions.
And one of those officers is currently incarcerated, mm-hmm. right? Yes, now for that is. And the mm-hmm. other one committed suicide. So mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so when this subject comes up and then you sit around the table, what are you doing? What are the plans? What are the initiatives to try to further stem the tide of this matter? Because I can tell you one thing. When I told you we were highly alarmed, and then when we came back and it seemed like, oh, well, it might not have been as bad, hearing this discussion.
It's a problem.
It's a crisis.
Yeah.
And can you give us a snapshot about, you know, sort of what's being said around the table with, you know, people who make decisions about what decisions they're going to make to try to stem this tide?
Well, what I say with the police investigation, it's the same as it always has been. Our primary goal is to reunite the missing person with their loved one. And if their home is unsafe, then we don't want them there, and we want to actually get them some services or some help. Mm. What I saw or I see as a problem and we're working on is to connect the families, not only the juvenile, like Sharece has stated and Derrica stated too, with some services. And so that's going to be on our new website, that people would be able to go on there and see the services that offered, because our job doesn't stop when we relocate the missing person, mm-hmm. but that's their entry point. So we should have some other avenues for them to get assistance, because sometimes it's an issue with the home and the parent, whether it's mental or substance abuse problem, unemployment, literacy, is some other issues that could be taking place in the home that's causing the teen to leave voluntarily. Mm-hmm.
Okay, who wants to take the first stab at? What do you want to see the media do?
We always say less is more. Less of one particular race and more of everyone that's missing, greater the chances of a reunion. We want to rely on them to be able to not be biased and share all the stories. I mean, we need more diversity in the newsroom. We've been turned away several times by them telling us our stories are just not sensational enough because of the color of our skin. And that has happened with our organization fighting for our families.
I've seen different mediums putting this conversation against each other versus realizing that we're on the same team.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is that mm-hmm. I'm saying, hey, Commander's doing a great job. Here's what we need to kind of back her up. Yeah. Here's what we need to enhance this process. Here's what we need to enhance our city. And I think that at the end of the day, we can make our city a model program, a model platform of these were the actions that were taken, these were the resolutions that we put in place that we can implement around the country. Because, you know, I'm getting calls from around the country about, hey, we have this problem too. What can we do? What steps can we take? What are you guys doing? I mean, they're literally calling me, and I'm referring them. I'm like, hey, Derrica, you know, this is Houston calling. Take this call, Derrica. Yeah, you know,
we have a real problem.
Houston, we have a problem.
We do. But I do applaud our lawmakers, because your efforts has awakened everyone. Yes. And I really think we need to look at this, not just on a DC level, mm-hmm. but on a national level. of looking at how, whether the Amber Alert needs modifications, how we're going to respond. Commander Dickerson was sharing, DC, there's no requirement as far as the reporting. That it's the same way in Illinois. It should be the same way
across the country.
Across the country, that if your loved one is missing and you know it is out of their character, then file the report. And then more importantly, let's get rid of the term runaway.
Yes, yes.
Okay,
yes.
Let's get rid of that, because if the parent or the family member don't know where their loved one is,
they're
and
missing.
Law enforcement don't know, they're missing.
Yeah.
And we have never classified anyone as runaways, because what deems them a runaway, especially we're working with the families and they're calling the police and they're like, my child didn't come home from school.
Yeah.
Why are they automatically being classified as a runaway?
Mm-hmm.
What based that decision?
I certainly see the distinction in that language.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. Definitely. And I think consistency in the media, not just because we have this flurry of activity, but consistency and keep the pressure on. And the social media was genius. I mean, we had to go to the next level in our technology. That's where you never know who's looking on Twitter and could see it, because I didn't know about it until I got on Twitter. Mm-hmm.
And we've been successful in reuniting a lot of families by the social media. I mean, I think one of the things, if someone calls you and asks you, I think they should take a page out of DC police book by putting this information out there, because you're putting it right in the palm of their hands.
Mm-hmm.
So we have our page and we're monitoring what MPD is doing, we're monitoring with Houston, Chicago, all around the country, because we are national, but we want to put this information in the palm of their hand.
When these kids go missing, are you finding that more kids are missing because they ran away from home? I know you said you don't like the runaway, but is that the issue, or more of them being seduced by untoward operators who want to use these kids? How does that break out?
I would like to answer first, because I want to use an example.
Mm-hmm.
Felicia Barnes, she was the teen that visited her sister. She came from North Carolina and went to Baltimore to visit her sister December 2010. She went missing. They classified her as a runaway. Mm. It took 10 days before the media even picked up the story. Come to find out, she was not missing, and her sister's boyfriend killed her. She was a student that was a senior that was supposed to go to Towson University. That is the example that I want to use, because that is what we see a lot. It's just that classification.
Stay away from runaway.
Yes.
Yeah. And that's why in MPD, we don't have the classification as runaway. And since the social media push, I have received a lot of inquiries where people are asking, what are the runaway numbers? And I always say that the word runaway has such a negative connotation for me. And even with the police department, if you want to make sure that we are, and we will be, are doing all that we can, and I want to make sure that the community is taking this seriously, and not, if I define a child as a runaway, will you really look for the child?
Right. They're
like
less
when
likely.
I say it's a critical missing person.
Mm-hmm.
When, when I put that flyer to say a critical missing person for that 14-year-old, everyone's watching.
And everybody's sharing it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes.
But
right.
when if I put a runaway 14-year-old, everybody's gonna look at, that's just a girl doing what girls do.
This is where we take issue with the new PSA. I think it was a great initiative, but the PSA solely speaks to runaways. And that is a part of the problem.
And the PSA from?
This was a part of one of the six initiatives that the mayor introduced. There's a PSA with local celebrities and those that are in media already.
Yeah.
And their PSA is solely speaking to don't leave.
Is runaway used?
Runaway is not used, if I can recall correctly. Runaway is not used, but it is a runaway hotline.
Uh-huh.
So it's basically saying that before you leave, talk to someone versus your question exactly.
Yeah.
Who's luring these children? I mean, and it may not be at the extreme of there being, the sex ring. And there's also the very real possibility, though.
Uh-huh.
Is that they could be being lured by those persons and then sent home.
Yeah.
Or there could be someone that's just maybe independently operating that's using the child and sending them home. But because children now are so easily influenced, who's the influencer?
So easily influenced, and so accessible unlike past times.
Oh, accessible, Rock,
Yeah. They're always checking in on social media. They're putting all of their information
out there.
You know, one of the things that we challenge parents to do is create fictitious accounts and try to befriend their child to see just how much information they're giving up online, because they are really giving up a lot of information. Mm-hmm. And I think it really, we need to buckle down on the laws as it relates to the penalty for human trafficking. For example, there was a gentleman 2 weeks ago. He was from New York. He was prosecuted in Detroit for human trafficking, and he received 3 to 10 years for human trafficking, just so he can just turn around and go do
it again.
How about, and I don't think I'm supposed to do this from this seat, but how about never get out of jail again if you want?
Well, I can agree with you.
I can agree with you, Rock. I'm working with all agencies because I agree that MPD is, I believe MPD is our first line of defense. Uh-huh. That's kind of the first place you go when you're trying to get information.
Right.
And secondly, we went to work with the Office of Unified Communications and we said, hey, you know, how can we enhance our technologies so that we can send text to 911? Because there may be a way that a quick a message could get through where there could be a tip, but so we found out that our 911 systems were analog systems. Mm-hmm. And so we did get with the director, and so she's reported by the end of May that we should be able to text the 911, and within the next year, we should be able to have technology in that 911 system that will pinpoint your location. Mm-hmm. Because a huge challenge is if you're calling 911, you're standing on hold explaining your location for 30 minutes before someone shows up.
Right.
So we're hoping now that we can get information quicker to 911, to police forces, and so that it, as a tip, you know, maybe someone sees something but doesn't have enough time to go through a 911 call when they can send a quick photo or send a quick picture. And that's what we're our resolution is introducing.
You know, this conversation, we mentioned boys, but we focused primarily thinking about women. Women. Why should parents be equally diligent about looking after their boys? How much is that? How much are boys being snatched up?
Back in 2008, the numbers were fairly the same, and the preceding year, the following year, I should say, the boys' numbers were higher. So yes, we have to realize that. First of all, our kids are dealing with so many pressures and, you know, wanting to fit in, and these predators are utilizing their peers to help recruit them. And so, you know, I know Fairfax County Police, they were searching for a young man that was actually trying to abduct a boy, you know, for gang-related purposes. So these are issues that we must look at, but I think we also have a deeper issue that we haven't discussed, and it's the lack of trust when it comes to the minority community and the police department. So we have to deal with that as well, because we have this notion, no snitching. We have to get out of that. If you see something, say something, because it could be a life or death situation.
And that goes both ways. Because my constituents say to me, well, the police wants us to say something to them about what we're doing when other officers are not talking about what other officers are doing if they see them operating in an illegal capacity. And so, and even if it's not illegal, it's operating out of context. You know, I've had personal encounters with officers that I've had the best experiences. I have a great officers that are friends. I recently moderated a panel full of officers that were focused on solutions. But then you have those officers who really are out of touch. They really are disconnected from the issues, and they're not as concerned as others may be. And so those officers are some of the reasons why people have the distrust. You know, are you turning in your officer friends? It's almost like I'll hear people say, well, when they start turning in officers, I'll start turning in other people. It's this kind of competitiveness that people are having to feel like, you know, until I see it's real for them internally, then we don't believe that it's real out here.
Reverend Harris, we often turn when we can't make a way out of no way.
Right.
We often turn to the church.
Right.
And you know, there are some passionate voices here.
Yes, and I'm hearing some some things that need to happen, because the church is that place that's in the community where we can bring all of this together and can bring consistency. And I'm just thinking about, you know, just grant building and ways that we can build capacity in different churches and different places in the district, in Maryland and DC. There's so much work to be done. And you had said when we were speaking in the back that a lot of people think that faith is just praying and not doing anything else. But we've got to put feet to our actions, to our faith. And praying can be walking. When I walk, I'm praying at the same time. So there's so much going on here. I'm getting ideas like crazy. I'm just thinking about all kinds of things that we could bring back to the table, back to the women at Metropolitan, because the women, they're ready to work. And there's so many churches. The church gets a bad name, but there's times that the church deserves a bad name. Sometimes we don't do anything. So there's a lot of work to be done, but there's a lot of churches out there that's ready to do the work.
Do you have an example of like an ongoing case that you all are focusing on?
All the cases that are open, we're focusing on those cases. You know, out of this area, yes, the Relisha Rudd, we have the Unique Harris, who's also missing out of DC, and she's been missing since October the 10th, 2010. She's the mother that had just moved up here from Richmond, and she was only here less than a month before she disappeared while her two young boys slept in the next room. You know, it's cases like those that really resonate with us, even with Pamela Butler. Pamela's brother, Derek, he's actually on my board. And just watching their struggle and just trying to help them and still continue to instill that hope. You know, when my phone rang in the early hours on Saturday morning and I answered the phone and all I could hear is Derek say, Jose was arrested. And I shot straight up in the bed and I said,
explain that, please, explain.
Pamela Butler was last seen on February the 14th, 2009. She had very high sophisticated cameras around her house. She was seen going in her house, but she was never seen coming out of her house. And she had met this man, his name was Jose, on the dating site eHarmony. They dated for about 5 months or so. He had a very extensive criminal history, violence against women. She had broken it off with him, or making plans to break it off with him, and I guess that just didn't go well. Well, she's been missing, and it was unusual because she was supposed to have dinner with her mom, and no one had heard from her. And so they went to the house. The house was completely cleaned. Sheets, everything off the bed. Like I said, her house was surrounded with surveillance. There was a window that was open, and Pamela was the type of person, she likes sunlight and she likes to lower her window from the top to let sunlight and fresh air come in. It was raised from the bottom, which is the exit point. We think that she went out of the house. And so I know that Chief Newsham assigned another detective. I know they've been working around the clock with this case, because like I said, Derek is a part of our team, but sometimes just putting another set of eyes on, because as an investigator, you know, you're seeing something, just like if you're looking at numbers, you keep seeing the numbers, you need to put a fresh set of eyes. And that's what happened in this case, where they were able to make a break in the case and he was arrested. But she was declared legally dead last year.
Still without being
How did that happen?
How does they
declare her legally
dead without? She's been missing for years, and this is something that the family has been working with as far as like law enforcement, and they had reason to believe that she was no longer here.
Commander, I want to give you the last word on this. We've got a minute left. I want to give you the last word. I mean, you're in an official capacity, representative of the government that's sworn to protect and serve. And so your commitment to the community is what?
My commitment is to find our missing teens and people of DC and connect them with the resources that they need. Derrica said in reference to say something, the community have to get involved and take ownership of their community. although it may be a situation where a police officer is not doing something that they should do, mm-hmm. however, it's your neighbor, like Unique Harris on Harford Street. Someone on Harford Street knows something about her disappearance, but they're not saying anything. Mm-hmm. So they're not, what her mother, Valencia, is feeling, the community is saying, oh, well, when the police steps up, then we're gonna step up. No, say something.
Let me tell you, I sit in this seat, and I sit in this seat because I've been given an opportunity to sit here by Howard University, the Brain Trust here at WHUT. WHUT is saw something, and WHUT is saying something and doing something. And I'm telling you, for the people that I have this relationship with, I could not be more proud. I want to say thank to each of you.
Thank you.
And thank you, Jeff Lee. Thank you, Luma. Thank you, Sharon. Thank you, everybody involved in this process. Thank you very much, Wally. Thank you very much, Cherie. Thank you, Avis. You all have seen something, and you're all doing something. And I am proud to be sitting here representing you. Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye. God bless. And if you see something, say something and do something. Thank you.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.